विद्यति भूदा विवाचम नानात्मानि प्रतिदिन भवदसा। In praise of Mother Earth, who is very Bhagutha, people of various every battles, Vivachan, of various realistic battles, Nana Dharman, practicing various religions and systemology of states, Prithivin Yathavatasa, and still treating all of them with uniform care, concern, and compassion, as the children of the same back. Sarasvam Dhara, Dravinasya Metuma, let that compassionate and universal Mother Earth shower all resources, Dhruvaya Dheru, Rutokspuranti, like a bounteous cow showers milk. This shloka quoted from the Veda, it gives a clear background about the diversities of the society on the basis of nationality, the ethnic backgrounds and religious disparities. In spite of these varying cleavages, still Mother Earth considers each and every denizen, inhabitant of the society, to be her progeny, to be her own child, treating him and bestowing on them the same level of resources, shower of resources that have been blissful to me, that have been universal to me, that have been gracious to me. Today, we have taken into consideration the paradoxical communion of three words, defense, law and peace. This defense is basically a biological instinct to say each and every root must be traced out, then expanded. Then on the basis of the practical utility for the circumstances and regional appropriations, we have to then decipher and execute that for generally the benefit of the topic which we are going to discuss. So it starts with defense. It is a biological instinct, basically, to prevent any external aggression. So to start with, there are some instinctive inputs or impulses that are unavoidable and common to all organisms, basically curiosity and fear. The level of curiosity and fear may be less in semi-sentient and ultra-sentient and infra-sentient beings, but man being a composite and rational and advanced animal as per the survey of biology and anthropology, no doubt he also has the replica of the basic feeling of insecurity which exists with all beings. And there is some sort of insecurity whenever we see something strange, something new, unknown. It is based on three main qualities. One is subjection. Whenever a person is subjected to an experience, then from the reading senses, similar feelings are brought out. And when similar circumstances arise, it creates a feeling of insecurity, which creates fear, then getting the defense mechanism to be brought out in the form of practical action. The second thing is inference. On basis of assumption values, this defense mechanism works out. Along with this inference as well as objection, that is the third phenomenon which is very unavoidable to all the people on various circumstances, that is suspicion. Everybody or each and every person engaged in the work of defense, engaged in pursuit of service, engaged in pursuit of protection, must see each and everything apart from the apparent visual vibration or from the apparent visual structure. The person must envision each and everything with a possible suspicion. Shankha, we used to say, Shankha. The second is known as Uha, third is known as Anubhuti. As per Shastra, these three things are the basic instincts for the defense mechanism. One is the person's previous experience, which leads a person to the defense process, kinetic or potential. The second is suspicion. Third is inference. So this is defense. On the basis of the defense mechanism, whenever a person sees something wrong in him, on the basis of his self-centric mechanism, which makes a person either to be rebellious or rebellious to prevent these things, or to have a counter mechanism in the methodology of attack. Then he is in the self-centric phase. The same thing is extended from a human being, from his own self towards his relations and possessions. To safeguard himself, he extends the defense practical outburst. The same thing is extended if the person is ecocentric. The person is physiocentric as well as ecocentric. The physiocentric expansion leads the person to take care, to protect and prevent his relations on the basis of, it may be on the basis of a physiological affinity or a psychological affinity or an intellectual communion, whatever it may be. Any type of this communion, the persons are then allowed to get into the embracement of a person's different mechanism. That is known as physiocentric, then relation, then ecocentric. He is with the same power, he is safeguarding his possessions, his land, his valuables, his valor, his pride, his honor. So each and every person, starting from self-protection, defense mechanism, in either they proceed towards safeguarding of their relations as well as their possessions. And in a broader way of the theories of geocentric or cosmocentric expansion, the person gets the glorious and the laudable instinct of safeguarding the nation. So the defense mechanism, it starts with a biological instinct of self-protection, which is extended towards the protection of his relations and possessions, which on the basis of his intellectual or spiritual evolution, which tempts the person to develop an instinct within the mind to serve for the nation, to protect the nation, to prevent the impending dangers of the nation and for the society. So this defense mechanism becomes kinetic, static and somnolent if the measures are there for preparedness, for prevention as well as to face anything. And when there is a practical aggression, practical fruitful aggression that is against it, it is transforming, the same thing is transforming into the form of a war. So defense is a biological instinct and war is an emotional outburst of the same instinct whenever a person is subjected to an impending danger by a practical and turbulent aggression. Whenever a person has no other way to safeguard himself or his dependent being, the national honor, the national pride, the national security or the success of the nation, he takes into war without minding the law of his mind. So taking this war, there are different approaches for defending this war. So there is nothing known as peace. As per general explanation, if we deeply go into the root of peace, there is nothing specially known as peace. A natural equilibrium state of the society or a mind or any atmosphere where there is no interruption of any external elements, any unwanted elements, any malicious elements, that state of total freeness from abnormality, disaster, confusion, or any state of imbalance of the various equilibriums of mind, state and status, that is known as peace. So peace is the undisturbed natural rhythm of the society as a whole. Before taking into consideration about the explanation of peace, one must be clearly known of the hindering factors or obstacles to peace. And the major obstacle to the peace is a war. Starting from a small spark of conflict between a person with another, it is a small scintillation. When it is blown as a radiant fire, it becomes conflict between two nations. If it is between two persons in a small form of conflict, it is at the micro level. The micro conflict is what we call hostility, and macro hostility is what we call war. And as it is in a macro level, the persons included are also more, and the loss is also irretrievable and colossal. So taking first war into scrutiny, there are different approaches to war. There are so many statements which glorify war, and there are so many statements to nullify war, totally prevent war. There are so many universal institutions, anti-war institutions, have been launched. And The explanation and approaches to the definition of war is psychological approach. Second is political approach, social approach, economical approach, anthropological approach, then evolutionary psychological approach. Various such approaches are there for understanding the nature of war, the root cause of war, and the prevention methodology. And there are different methods. And taking into consideration the various war systems and war philosophies, and also coming to the justification principle of Srimad Narayana in the form of Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, we have to read something about war by which the methodology for arriving at peace will be implied and peace will become an inbuilt benefit and mechanism inside the war prevention or war minimization. So, first, there are so many people against the war. For example, Roosevelt, he clearly told there are having only two options. One, we all have to die together or we have to live together. And if we want to preserve the learning of living together, we have to talk. So this is a statement of Roosevelt. And instinct, the famous thinker, from scientist, from social philosopher, and also a spiritual aspirant, he quoted, I don't know with what weapons the third war will be fought, but I know that the fourth world war will be fought with sticks and stones. So this is a statement of Professor Einstein. He clearly told that one more Professor war will totally uproot the civilization, culture, or even the total inhabitation system of the cosmos. The whole earth. And there are so many things. And Plato clearly told that only those who are dead in war can see the end of war. This is a statement of Plato. These people are totally against war. No war. Total anti-war. And there are some people who consider the bifurcation of war, one from the initiating end and second from the inventor end. There are two ends in a war. Both of the people are initiating the war. With mutual hostility, that is okay. That is absolute brutalism. If there is one side, which is the initiating side or a provoking side for war, the second side, it rests in the pride of the nation, the glory of the national organization, the prestige of the government or the other institution ruling the nation to take that challenge. Otherwise, it has been clearly told in the address of Chief Guest, when there are options between cowardice and war or violence, then the best preference is war. So if it is invited, if it is uninitiated, the Yadruchaya Toba or Nam, so Krishna says, it is justification process of war in which he clearly legalizes war. Enters war to Arjuna, he says. So it is not initiated by us. We have been invited. So this is the end of invitation, that is the end of initiation. So for the people, those who invite war, initiate war, it is an embodiment of brutality. And for those who are invited and those who are waiting for sacrifice for the nation, therefore the subject, it is an embodiment of bravery. So bravery and brutality depends upon a person's being initiator or being invited. So these bifurcations are there. Well known from the Shakespeare statement, he differentiates in King Henry about this peace as well as war. When peace is taken into account, no doubt we can be having humbleness, modesty, and humility. But when the blast of war blow in ears, imitate the action of a tiger, stiffen the sinews and summon up the blood. This is the statement of King Henry. So there is a compact between a person's moral sentiments and sentiments of patriotism, sentiments of taking into care of the substances of the welfare of the nation as well as the subjects, then the person becomes an icon of bravery, an icon of courage, an icon of ray of hope and confidence and dawn for the society and future. So here explaining the various opportunities that Arjuna had met in the Arjuna Vihara Yoga, Krishna gives various justifications. The first justification is philosophical, eschatological, ontological and metaphysical, which may not be applicable to all people. These are two statements. One is najayate namriyate. First, before taking into the explanation the phenomenon of war, Krishna first explains the effect of war, the phenomenon of effect of war, which is destruction. What is the effect of war? One is victory, second is destruction. Taking into explanation and elucidation, Krishna first quotes the phenomenon of destruction. He says that nothing is destructed. Na jayate na mriyate. Nothing is born and nothing is extirpated. And second thing is, jatasya hi dhruva mrityu. Dhruvan janma mrutasya cha. So birth and death are inevitable phenomena of the perpetual cycles of must be functioning. So he says this philosophical justification. And in order to prevent the hasty generalization of this philosophical solution for whom is homicide, then genocide, patricide, and everything, soul is imperishable. And death and birth is the order of the universe, so we can kill any person at any time. Because that is imperishable, I am not killing anything and nobody has been killed. So, in order to prevent this hasty generalization of this philosophical certainty, which can be misappropriated by crooked-minded personalities, Krishna laid down the exceptions and the certainty so that this can be clearly understood. A person taking the righteousness in his hand, with sincerity and patriotism in his mind, with a vigilant and intelligent approach for safeguarding the national mechanism in his brain, for such a person, this philosophical pursuit comes for relief and solace. For those persons who are going for rational approach, realistic approach, righteous approach in this war pattern, who is fighting for morality, righteousness, religiosity, eternity and principles of truth and perfection. For those people who used to have somewhat a feeling of discouragement in which they feel that unavoidably it has to result in lateral, bilateral and collateral damages in wars. So for those people, those who are taking the path of righteousness, Krishna gives a solution not for the crooked people and brutal leaders or the senior leaders. So here the second thing he says is swadharma. See, if you have taken, just as a surgeon takes a knife and removes the unwanted portion, surgeon, like as Johnson clearly told, the best surgeon is a person not only knowing to do surgery, but cleverly knows how maximum he can avoid it. So, rectification process is called. Methodologies of arbitration, negotiation, advice, everything is there. And in the stories of Ramayana and Mahabharata, we know the messenger Ancharya given to Ravana and Krishna himself proceeded to Duryodhana for a peace negotiation. So, after all of the other tools, pre-war tools are totally exhausted and put into drastic failure, the ultimate weapon that has been taken is total destruction. Just as a doctor removes the process of amputation, removes a portion that is injured as well as collapsed. Where self-construction is impossible, self-rejuvenation is impossible, where it may penetrate and be pernicious to other existing planetary systems of the body, then it is amputated by a doctor. Likewise, the military principles, the war principles, if applied in the sense of righteousness in the right form, it is a social surgery. It is a social surgery by which the incorrigible elements who cannot be put into right track as well as they are pernicious to the already existing, they will permeate into the other existing systems of the society, resulting into the total turmoil. In order to avoid the total turmoil, it is known as, in spite of loss, it is known as loss minimization process. So it is a surgery, it is known as social surgery. So Krishna says, it is your swadharma. Taking it upon the benefit of large prosperity, peace, these things are the attributes and benefits meant for the innocent and pious. Just as we used to say, peace is the language of wise and fools cannot apprehend it. And peace is the benefit for the virtuous and pious, and the malicious cannot hold it. And peace, it is the melody of a soul, and those who are dumb with violence and vengeance, they cannot sing it, they cannot realize it. So, those who are pernicious to the system cannot be brought into the facilities of correction, rectification, repatriation, tracking, and reorbit fixation. For those people, the ultimate application is amputation, which is now explained as social surgery. So, Krishna clearly explains that it is your swadharma, you are a doctor, meant for removing the portions which are very pernicious to the other existing innocent, ignorant, and deserving citizens of the society. And second thing is, he clearly says, it is yadruchaya chopapanna. Arjuna, you are not calling anybody for one. They have called you. See, there is a basic instinct. In military technology, there is a basic instinct. The best or the worst even, the insecurity is the knowledge about the availability or survival of an enemy. Understand? Basic, best or worst instinct of insecurity is if a person, that is also in the strategy of the Vedic study, they used to say that just as Vali, anybody fighting with Vali, they will lose the strength, they will become 1 by 1, they will become 1 into 2. Like that, any escaping or left out enemy, as per military strategy, they will become double strength and he is an ever existing menace to the national security and threat to the parties. And anybody who is allowing a person to get out or to go out by evasion and escape technologies, that person is half strengthened. So that person is double strengthened, this person is debilitated. So Krishna says, he has come, even if you escape, he will kill you if you are not ready to kill him. Even if you escape, if he has called you for war, he will come and kill you. For self-protection, as you are not an individual, you are having thousands of dependents, lakhs of subjects, for them, as a protector, if you reading the script of thousands of people, if you lose your courage and we are lost, you are also sponsoring the loss of lives of your dependents. You have right to lose your life, but not at the cost of the loss of several lakhs of your dependents. So taking into consideration the dependents whose life, courage and valor is based on your survival and your potential outburst in this war, you must get and you must come straight forward to the war and have the peace. And Krishna clearly told two options, and one option is mundane and second option is transcendental. Hey Arjuna, if we fight here, hatova prapsyasi swargam, if you are killed in this battle, you will reach the abode of heaven. Jitva bhokshase mani, if you win, you can rule the kingdom. So in either way you are benefited. So God gives the metaphysical solution in which benefit is a both ends. Even if you survive, you can have a better survival. Even if you lose your life, it is a better loss. It is a transcendental loss. It is a benevolent loss. It is a magnanimous loss. So both are these ends you are getting the benefit. So thus, war is justified by Krishna. That it is a symbol of bravery. If you are invited and you are fighting for a righteous cause, then comes the peace. What is peace? I have clearly told that it is a biological instinct with defense and emotional outburst of the same instinct with war. Then, soul is a spiritual instinct is peace. Peace comes out from assumed soul. So, a soul in its balanced equilibrium, emits radiations of peace by which a person is self-established as well as radiate the surroundings to establish peace everywhere. So, to arrive at peace, peace is the goal, just as it has been rightly told by somebody. There is no way for peace, peace is the way. That is the statement, there is no way for peace, peace is the way. So what do we want? Through defense, war, these things are just means Our goal is not to become the war. We have to get peace. For getting that peace, we have two tools. One is defense, to be prepared. To be prepared, to be systematically ready, to be full-fledged. To be full-fledged for prevention, protection and protest. And second, war, it is in a potential status. By defense and war, we want to establish only peace. Because I already told, peace initiatives cannot be so much valid or efficacious in all angles. How can you talk? For example, if there are two people speaking with each other. One person is holding a white flag. Second person is having a gun. This person is having any rice, mercy and compassion. That person is having violence. This person's mind is full of altruism and peace initiative. That person's mind is full of fighting and self-establishment. That person's mind and brain is very much cultured and civilized by cosmopolitan principles. This person's brain is crooked. How an effective communication can take place between those two people? It is very impossible. So, effective communication can take place only between two like-minded people. Two people who are in the equilateral plane. Two people who are in the equipotential pursuit. Two people who are in the equi-intellectual status. Two people who are in the equi-principled status. So unless the people, they are unified and they begin to be perfect tools of mutual communication are developed, it won't be effective. So peace initiatives are meant for people only if they are either peacemakers or peace lovers. There are a few people who are peacemakers in the society, and there are innumerable people to say, to brief, there are uncountable people, and all the every peacemaker to transform or to take into that project each and every peace lover of the society, to convert them into peacemakers and distribute the valuable message of peace in the society for maintaining the same. So peace dialogue may be possible and effective only if the persons are peace oriented. For those other people who cannot understand the language of peace and white flag, then the language must be in the form of war, and essential mechanism may be a military mechanism. So, as it has been clearly told in Bhagavad Gita, about the varieties of society, those who can be terrorized and threatened by a defense mechanism, that is okay. And those who are rashes and impotent to come for war, then we have to speak with war. And those who are ready for peace and those who are like-minded, we have to take the initiative of peace. But by defense, by war and by peace initiatives, we want to establish that shanti, 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 indoor, shanti, different shanti. So many natural factors and so many artificial factors, if they are imbalanced with their equilibrium, they result in ashanti, peacelessness. So prithivi shanti. If earth lacks of peace, then it comes in the form of earthquakes. Then vanaspati shanti, forest fire, tsunami, there are various types of such abnormalities in the natural system mechanism. So we want peace, and with the help of the unseen guiding spirit, the imperceptible divinity, taking that as a supporting and additive force, with all of our might, courage, distribution of knowledge, distribution of institutionalization of our principles for the society to make the peace to be practical and effective, we have to do that. And to brief that, there are only two principles which made this bifurcation as it has been founded by our ancestors. One is the power of love, and second is the love for power, they used to say. And the power of love unifies everything and we can arrive at peace. And the love for power, either it may be religious, regional, ethnic, or whatever may be the background. If there is a love for power, love for domination, love for trampling on other sides to be thrown, then it results in a perpetual cycle of miseries, perpetual cycle of total annihilation, the society with its values. Let us hope and pray for this awareness in the society. For example, you see, if you have organized a ritual, a homa, or a pilgrimage to Kashi or any other temple, I could have got a better number of audience. And moreover, the number of audience are lesser than the number of visitors to my place. People, they resort to religion because of their bodies and justification of their lust and interest of avarice and fear. Avarice to get more benefits and fear of their mistakes. So everybody has to visit. And whenever that comes to intellectual exposure and exploration, the people are very limited. This irresponsible and irresponsive society must be nurtured and nourished with proper knowledge. Not by asking them to come before us, but by approaching the society, coming down to the level, translation of these things, distribution of these things in the form of any material to educate them in the field of knowledge. For example, whatever he has told, the chief guest, if the audience here who believes, digest, assimilate, understand and apply with the basic knowledge of what he has spoken, the country will get a battalion of valuable soldiers who are more valuable, precious, efficacious and hyper potential than even the battalion soldiers. To a right place, just as good seeds have to be sown in a thin soil, in that there is proper manure, irrigation and fencing, this thing must reach the exact audience, the effective audience of the society, and it is not a single day thing. See, construction mechanism is not a single day work, because it is a deep-rooted mechanism that exists in society over thousands of years, centuries, millennia. So it takes lot of people, lot of institutions, with lot of seminars, and lot of campaigns, a lot of awareness. Institutions have to be established. They must be made with educational syllabus, apart from the other advanced things that are put in these competitions and in examinations, which are not going to serve the practical purpose of a person's patriotism and development of a nation. Such things like ethical leadership, the national security, the citizenship values, the history, the Holocaust, see, the destruction of a nation. There are two things which can bring spirit to the citizens to become a patriot. One, the pride of the past. And the laws of the present. How glorious we were, that must be shown to the people, to the students. And what is our present position? I am saying that there must be a boiling in the blood. There must be some sort of a dynamic outburst, explosion, which must turn into tactical unification, resulting in the real goal and achievement of our institution, not only our institution, the government institution as well as any other institution which is maintained for, which is meant for and maintained for welfare of the society. Let us hope and pray. The choice of blessings of the ultimate spirit, the cosmic engineer and the super cosmic designer and the ubiquitous, omniscient, all-pervading personality of Godhead to shower his choice of blessings to extend the longevity, to give them physical, psychological, intellectual and spiritual progress for all the participants and concerned persons of this society, as well as this subject, as well as this theme and institution, to get into the relentless task of unifying like-minded people in representation of the society, which is that deeply overwhelming negligence, ignorance and subservience to create a unified global citizenship and fraternity. Narayana. Even though they are like-minded, they are of single opinion, frequency of meeting, integrity and commitment. If two people who are in the process of destroying the nation meet together, they will forget about themselves and they will think about destruction. But two people, knowledgeable people, meet together in constructive process, they will forget about constructive process, think about themselves, about personal mutual egoism and priority and preferences. So, why it is so? Because negativity has inbuilt power. Because it is everywhere. You know that small insects, as they are ephemeral in nature, their productivity, their expansion, growth, everything will be stricter than the other organisms. Why? Because they are ephemeral. Eternal organisms, that too, intellectual evolution of human beings also exists with physical growth, so everything. But negativity is very powerful. Not only because that it is powerful, it has limited power, but the power is distributed within a limited span of time. The RPM level is more because it is ephemeral, it has to execute and exhaust the whole RPM level within that lifespan. That is the greatness of negativity. That's why we used to say even practice, vairagya, sadhaka, all these things say asura sadhaka, not deva sadhaka. Now, the person is very urgent, the legitimate practitioner used to say asura sadhaka, he has done asura sadhaka, not deva sadhaka. So, because it is assumed in nature, so let you be divine in heart, but in your action be assumed. against the arthritic forces. If the forces are arthritic, it will be hyperarthritic, ultra-arthritic to be able. So, this is the problem between the positive forces, lack of continuity, integrity, fidelity, and commitment. These are all various other things essential for a quality leadership which can take this into pathway. So, I have thought about two things. One is the lineage of guidance, the perpetual lineage of guidance. If I give you good guidance, people are so potentially stamped by the other extra scriptural benefits and graces. I am not going to give. That is the difference between a preceptor, philosopher and a preacher. The preacher gives you only this book. He used to say there are three nyayas. One is the Bhikshuka Nyaya, Atithi Nyaya and Sutta Nyaya. So the Atithi, the guest leader of asking what food? So the Atithi, the guest leader of asking what food? Your beggar is also demanding food and your son is also asking for food. You are going to feed them. First, for a beggar, he will be placed in his respective place, he will be given his respective food and in the center. And an Atithi, a guest, will be formally invited, given on seat, not only given the food asked, but also some extra support. But for your son, you will give not only food, regular food, care, comfort, give your properties, everything. Yes. Yes, undemanded. Ayachita phala. Means after it. Ayachita phalam api dadati mata. Then you need not demand these things. So you need not ask for these things. Likewise, a mere preacher gives you the benefits of the book. Why not? There is a book that you can repeat. And if you arise any doubts, in within his limited exposure. And secondly, a philosopher treats you like an Atithi. Not only the book contents, the subtleties of the book and values of the book will also be important. If you are going to a hotel, they will give just only food. There are two basic requirements or two basic requisite instincts before the consumption and after the consumption of food. The preconsumptive and find the prerequisite for having the food, appetite, she will kindle that appetite by giving ginger or some other appetizer. If it is not digested, she will give some other supportive element for digestion. So, that is the difference between preaching and your preceptorial influence, an acharya and a shikshakara adhyapaka. So, an acharya, the margadarshaka, the torch bearer of the society, not only is giving you knowledge, but if you are devoid of the appetite for knowledge, he kindles the appetite. If you cannot assimilate it, he makes you to assimilate, realize, practice and achieve it. He sees that you achieve it. No doubt we require thousands of preachers, but at least we require at least a dozen of preceptors for creating a renaissance in the society, resulting in all around happiness and prosperity. That is what Karats are told in his value added education. What is that value? That value is nothing but, see, there are a lot of ciphers, there is only one. That one that vivifies that cipher to get some value. What is that value? That value is not professional value or higher academic persuasion to the time immemorial cyclic vicious circles of poverty, racism, religious clashes, communal clashes, and other ugliness of this society. So that is what we require now. And this is the work of social intelligence. Right? Military intelligence is defined to be the intelligence of the military people, intelligence of the military people about the military operations. Social intelligence is intelligence of the society about the social operations. That is the basic root cause of a person's depression, failure and everything. It is the root cause of all miseries, as told by Buddha. Desire, unless if it is kept under the lotus feet of the Almighty, the inexhaustible source of desire and bliss, all the other rest sources of desire, they are nothing but melancholy in disguise. So, that particular desire, that is not every prudential phenomenon by which we can operate the social system. For example, you are going to a medical shop. There, if you want to purchase any medicine for eradication of any predicament, you will go as per the prescription of a doctor. who are Wagner's view, who are interpreting.